Good evening and welcome to Border Live. A discussion is already underway. We're talking about sexual morality, Victorian values, or is it all just sexual hypocrisy? Also in the programme, we'll be talking to Paul Raymond from Raymond's Review Bar. Many people feel that his type of entertainment is the best of its kind that you can get. We shall see when we talk to him. There's plenty more in Border Live. And we're looking for your phone-in comments as well. Phone us now on the borderline. What do you think? Carlisle 37171.
Right, with us in this evening's discussion, we've got feminist author Dr. Germain Greer, we've got Victoria Gillick in the news all this week again, and we've got Bill Buckley, who's an apologist on the part of the gay community. Is that fair, Bill?
Yep, that certainly is.
Right, but let's go to Victoria first, because you're back in the news again. You're most well known for your campaign to make sure that girls under 16 don't get the contraceptive pill without their parents knowing. In fact, your campaign has been overturned, hasn't it, until very recently.
Well, to an extent, the Law Lord's ruling certainly was a setback. I thought it was far worse than, in fact, I now realise that it was.
But the Law Lords actually said that girls could get the pill under 16 without their mums and dads knowing, didn't they?
In certain circumstances, you see, if a person can give a legally valid consent to treatment, then they have confidentiality, that's their right. But if they can't give a valid consent, then confidentiality doesn't apply. And all the General Medical Council, which is what you've seen in the papers, has said that if she can't give a valid consent, then it's up to the doctor what he does next.
The General Medical Council has in fact said that if a girl seems immature to the doctor, he can then consult her parents. Is that correct?
Well, that was the wording of the Law Lords. She has to have sufficient maturity and understanding to make a legally valid consent to treatment. That's the same with adults as well, of course.
Do you feel that that's a movement in your direction? Is that something you welcome this week?
It's more in the direction of the GP rather than the parents' direction, though parents now can feel they won't automatically be deceived. And GPs now feel they automatically won't be reported to the GMC for telling a parent if he thinks it's in the child's best interest.
Victoria, we've started with you because, in a sense, you're the most topical person here. You're right in the news this week. But let's bring it to Germain. Germain, how do you feel about Victoria? Victoria is really set up as the archetypical Earth Mother figure in favour of traditional family values, and you are not. And how do you see yourself now in relation to Victoria?
I look more like an Earth Mother than Victoria, wouldn't you say?
I would not say.
The unfortunate thing about the media is that they can only think in stereotypes. Victoria has 10 children, therefore she must be a professional mother.
She's also very much in favour of young girls under 16 not having sexual intercourse or their parents knowing about it. So she's seen, therefore, as protective of children, protective of the family.
Well, we're all, in a way, I suppose, protective of children. It's such a confused situation. How can a girl be of the age of consent for sexual intercourse if she's not of the age of consent to use some precaution against the possible consequences of sexual intercourse?
So what you're saying is that Victoria must be wrong. If she can have sex, she must be able to have contraceptives of her own accord.
I'm so glad that Victoria exists and fights this particular battle, because somebody has got to convince the doctors that they're really not up to taking all this responsibility. And in the case of the pill, you've got most little girls, most girls under 18, say, are not regularly ovulating. They are not actually terrifically fertile. But you're going to treat them as if they were, and you're going to give them a steroid which is going to affect their future maturing.
So you're against the pill on chemical grounds, on physical grounds, not necessarily on moral grounds.
I also think the pill's not very good for sex, if you want the truth.
It doesn't
have...
Are we going to be technical? I think we probably
are. Quickly technical, yes.
Well, it doesn't have a very good effect on natural secretions. It makes them disappear. They don't smell the same. We don't quite understand the role of pheromones in human sexual response, but we do know that there is one, and we do know that if you give people steroids, they're likely not to produce the right signals.
So are you two ladies moving together? Are you both moving towards the idea of the family, the great conservative, traditional Victorian values?
Well, you put like that, you don't have to make it sound like horrible. I think we're moving probably towards something that's a bit more natural and a bit more wholesome, a bit more enjoyable.
Right, at this point on the natural and wholesome, let's bring in Bill, because a lot of people would say that homosexuality is not natural, it's certainly not wholesome, and why are you an apologist for the gay community?
Well, it's existed as long as heterosexuality has. I think many people in their lives, even if they are now married with children and all that, will remember at some stage in their life where they had feelings towards their own kind. And not everybody needs to be heterosexual. It's not necessary for everybody to reproduce. And it seems to me that if you're not harming other people and if you're finding happiness in your own way, then it doesn't necessarily matter how you do it.
Victoria, can I ask you to comment on what Bill said?
Well, I'm afraid I'm going to have to be a bit tough here, because I do rather tend to think of homosexuals, practicing homosexuals, rather like I regard drunken drivers. You know, they're very nice people, and what they do is probably perfectly okay. When they start killing and maiming and injuring people by their activities, either spread a disease or whatever, I feel that, you know, a little bit wary of them. So I'm afraid I do regard them as rather social delinquents.
Can you come back on
yes,
that, Bill?
Well, I'll tell you, the mistake I think you're making is that you should equate an ordinary homosexual with a social drinker rather than with a drunken driver. Most gay people have few partners, or one partner. I know gay people who have had the same partner for years and years. They're not spreading any risk of infection. And besides which, is it not also true that heterosexual sex, if it's... If there are lots of different partners involved, is also liable to do that.
Quite true.
It's very unfair.
They're a bit delinquents too. But I think, nowadays,
all right,
I think we can. Let's say, 20 years ago, we were innocents as far as this is concerned. Now we're not, so we'd better start waking up to what's happening.
Don't you think it's better then,
Can I cut in before we move on to whether or not it's better and go to Paul with the audience? Because I think there are plenty of people who are dying to get in on this one.
Yes, we have Dr. Nigel Cameron, a Church of Scotland minister and does a lot of work in Scotland. What's the Church's view on this? You said to me that you thought you were here to be conservative. Well, is that what you are?
Well, I think we are, but I think one of the very interesting things about this whole discussion, and it comes out in some things that Germain Greer has been saying and has been writing in recent years, is that we are now facing some of the consequences of the kind of liberalisation of sexual attitudes which took place 20, 30 years ago. And we aren't at all happy with many of these consequences. And many of the sort of things that the Christian Church has been saying all along are now being shown to be quite sensible things and not simply old-fashioned.
So you're saying some of the things, perhaps like AIDS, it's sort of like the punishment of God?
I wouldn't say AIDS was the punishment of God, but I would say that if people start doing things that God would prefer they didn't do in their own interest, things can begin to go wrong.
Let's open it up to the audience. Has anybody got anything that they want to say on what the discussion?
Yes, I would think, describing Bill Buckley as gay is very bad. It gives it a sinister meaning, and gay isn't that sort of a word. He's a homosexual, and like his kind, he's practicing. Let's be clear about it. Legalized filth. That's what he's doing. They're corrupting children. Oh, you are. They're corrupting children. You see? And let me go on. They've brought AIDS. Let me finish this. They've brought AIDS to this country. Yes? Oh, going to be 40,000 this year with the AIDS virus?
Bill,
you don't like the truth,
my
friend.
You must come back on that point, I'm sure.
Certainly, that is not the truth at all.
I
am not a danger
society.
To
society.
Excuse me. Excuse me. I live my life with one partner, and I have done that for nearly 3 years.
And it's disgusting.
Look, it may disgust you, but things you do may disgust me, and you don't have the right to decide what in this world is right and wrong. You have your opinion, and I have my opinion, and everybody has different opinions. And that is surely what we get from living in a democracy, and living in a fair world where people can make up their own decisions. And how dare you say that?
Now, a child has just been born with the AIDS virus. What do you say to that?
I say it's extremely sad, but I say that a very small number gay people in America with a large number of sexual partners are partly responsible for this problem. The vast majority of gay people are no more responsible for it than the majority of straight people.
Right, can I come from Bill back to Germain? One of the things that was made by the Church of Scotland minister was the idea that in fact we're moving back towards traditional values because of the problems which promiscuity in the 60s and 70s caused. Is that what is happening to you, Germain? Are you moving back towards traditional values because of what happened?
I haven't got much in
70s?
Common with the Kirk of Scotland, I'll tell you that right now. No, what's happening to me is that I'm simply carrying on the same boring old line of argument I've been doing for 20 years, but no one's ever listened to it.
We're listening.
What I used to say was that we had, of course, women's sexuality had to be liberated, but you would not get liberated sexuality while you had oppressed people. You would just get more of the same. So women became more accessible sexually. But that didn't mean that they were sexually liberated, because they were still at the mercy of the dominant sex. They still had a kind of sex which wasn't necessarily the sex they really wanted.
Every questionnaire comes up with the same thing. Many women have sex when what they really want is affection. They want to be talked to. They want to be understood. Instead, they have sex.
Right, I wonder if I could ask you to phone in on Carlisle 37171 with your opinions on this particular discussion. 37171. Paul, over to you.
Right, who else in the audience? Dr. Cameron, do you want to come back on that?
I think I should like to, particularly because of the exchange about homosexuality which has just taken place. I mean, I certainly believe, as the Christian Church has always believed, that the practice of homosexuality is wrong. Yeah. But I also think I ought to say that it's very important that we should conduct these discussions in a friendly and respectful way. And in saying that I think homosexual practice is mistaken, I don't at all mean that I don't have respect for people who think otherwise, and I think that should be stated.
Let's widen it up to the audience. Who else would like to put a point? The gentleman at the back, you were telling me you've got, what, three girls. What's your view?
I think as far as homosexuality is concerned, I believe it's an unnatural thing to do. I believe that it's man and woman. And I think it's most unfair for the viewers to be put forward in that way, as if somebody's got to come into it somewhere, and they're influenced, and it's an evil influence.
Let's ask a lady. Stephanie Tobin, what's your view?
It is a natural thing. I don't like homosexuals. I mean, it's as simple as that.
What about the general topic of morality, though? Do you think that we should be going back to Victorian values?
I think we have to go back to Victorian values, because if the family is going to survive as a unit, that's the only thing you can do.
Is that the general consensus? Is that what people think here?
No.
Going back?
No.
You don't think you should go back. Liz?
Can I bring in Victoria? I mean, lots of people think that that's what you stand for, a return to Victorian values, Victorian Gillick values.
Child prostitution, rape, abuse, unemployment, poverty. I think we've got it, don't you?
We have returned in that sense, you think.
We have returned.
But then again, what about what people would call old-fashioned values? Monogamy, fidelity, children, as the centre of our existence.
Oh, heavens, when anybody gets married, they marry for life, don't they? That's what they believe.
But that's not what you believe, Germain, is it?
The fact that it breaks down doesn't mean people don't stop believing.
You don't believe that we marry for life? You think marriage is a form of convenience, a form of social settlement, and then people have bits on the side? Isn't that what you think now?
No. I've always been against divorce, which might sound a very odd position to take, because I think women suffer the most through divorce. A serial monogamy means that as a man rises in the world, he can get younger and smarter wives and cast off the old ones and any children they might have had. The same chances don't really exist for a woman, and for an abandoned woman with growing children, the situation is really grim. And under the reign of Saint Thatcher, it's even worse than it used to be. I think that marriage is not based on sex. It ought not to be. If it is based on sex, you can't rely on sex. It's too volatile. Sexual attraction pops up, goes down, disappears, lasts, doesn't last. Do you realize what kind of an industry we have that tells women every single day how to keep their husband's sexual interest? And we've even got to the stage where you can bring pornography into the marital chamber and get each other excited by using commercial stimulants. And I think, just wait a minute. If you're not sexually interested in each other anymore, that doesn't mean you have to get divorced. It doesn't mean your marriage is dead. There's friendship, there's all the things you've done together.
What you're actually saying is that marriage is irrelevant to sex, in a sense. It's a social setup, and sex is not part of it, or need not be.
It might even be inimical to sex. I mean, I think the people who need marriage are the children. The children need their parents to be married. And one of the things that shocks me when people break up marriages is that they simply have no imagination about the size of the catastrophe it is very often for the children.
Victoria, would you go along with that? Do you think that marriage matters more than anything else, more than sexual togetherness or anything?
Well, I think the sexual side of marriage is the balm that gets you over the hard times in the beginning of it. You know, when you're getting to know one another, it's what knits up the ragged edges of the day, if you like. Yes, it is.
But
important.
Is it vital?
But it's not the only, as Germain says, it's not the only thing. If it was, well, most people would sort of pack up marriages by the time they reach 50.
But Bill,
they?
On that argument, could a homosexual man have a perfectly happy married relationship and have his bits on the side and they'd be men?
Well, I would think that any relationship where one of the partners was having bits on the side, whatever their sex, there is something wrong there that needs looking into, and it's a situation that needs putting right. So
right,
the answer would be no.
At that point, Bill, let's go over to Paul.
Yes, we've had some phone reaction. David Patrick of Carlisle said that God's law is that a man loves a woman, nothing else. Mr. Johnson of Dumfries said Victoria Gillick should keep her ideas to herself and the name of the game should be mutual agreement. We'll be coming back to that subject, but it's also Valentine's Day, February the 14th, and we're looking at couples and how they react to each other. Border Television actually invented that, some say, the longest-running quiz show on ITV where couples get together, and this is what this looks like. See what you think of Mr. and Mrs.
You're doing well, Angus is saying, you're doing well. And you are doing well. Right, come forward a wee bit, young lady. We want to hear this answer loud and clear, because it's £2,800. Which of these events would you prefer... He's got his fingers crossed, he's got them there. Would you prefer to take part in for charity? Which event? You could go and do a donkey derby for charity, a sponsored walk for charity, a knitting competition for charity, or a cookery competition?
Or knitting.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Well, that's the way that Mr. and Mrs. does. The discussion's still getting going in the studio, but we're also talking about Valentine's. With me, Des Mason from West Cumbria, who does Valentine's rhymes. That's one of the things that it is. Give us a couple of rhymes.
Well, we've got a nice clean one here. I want no salacious innuendo, nothing unrefined, but just to say, I love you madly. Be my Valentine.
Another one.
Well, you want a dirty one? Be my Valentine, that's an order. I want your peninsula next to my border.
How did you get to start this?
Well, it was a thing that I started off a few years ago and dropped it very promptly, I should say, but it was resurrected by you.
What we want you to do, Des, is to go amongst the audience, pick a couple of people, go and write them, and we'll see you back, and we'll find out what Valentines you've got for our audience. Okay, right, Liz.
Right, phone reaction coming in thick and fast now. Christopher Hind of Wigton says that Victoria Gillick's view is very harsh, that sex before marriage is very important to many young couples. And then we have three messages that have come in simultaneously from Mr. Griffiths, from a lady in Whitehaven, from a gentleman in Carlisle, all saying to Bill Buckley, stick at it, you shouldn't have been abused like that.
Thank you.
Yeah, seems to be.
Thank you very much.
Could we come back to Victoria, though, and that first point that was made? Many young couples today think sex before marriage is vital. Would you go along with that?
Well, you know that my own campaign has been to do with the under-16s, because parents are responsible for their children. They're responsible in law, poor things, up to 17 or 18. But whilst they're under 16, there's even a much more closer bonding, because the children are more vulnerable, and parents do sense that.
But technically, so, I suppose, if one can marry at 16, then sex before marriage must inevitably include the under-16s,
Not inevitably. And it's only become inevitable now because we think we have the means to stop pregnancies. But those means are, in fact, putting girls' lives in jeopardy themselves.
Are you against all contraception or just the pill for girls under 16?
Well, that's my own particular personal point of view. But I'm surprised in the sense that I'm coming across more and more young women who find mechanical, chemical forms of contraception totally unacceptable.
Again, Germain, this is really one of your own campaigns, that you've moved away from the idea of mechanical and chemical contraception, correct?
I was never actually for them, if you remember. I was pretty nasty about the pill and the female eunuch, which is more like 20 years ago than 10, you know.
That's my failing.
You know, one of the things is that we've got very boring about sex itself. We think the way people should make love, heterosexuals that is, most of us are not quite sure what it is homosexuals do, but we'll march in the street for their right to do it. But when it comes to heterosexuals, we know exactly what they ought to be doing. The concept of normal sex only applies to heterosexuals. And it turns out that normal sex is the kind that will result in having babies if you don't do something about it, which means we imitate impregnation and we call that lovemaking. Now, do you not remember all that stuff when you were growing up about French kissing and the way the French make love and more sophisticated ways of doing it and so on? One of the things that's wrong with the way we make love is it's so unimaginative.
So you're into the heavy petting routine?
Well, there's more to it than heavy petting. I'm into what you might call polymorphous perversity. In other words, I'm just as queer and unnatural as he is. And
well,
probably more so.
More.
Well, I'm the most promiscuous person in the room. You want to attack somebody. Besides, I'm more like your size and all. The point is that there's nothing natural about human sexuality. It's a cultural construct. Everybody behaves according to learned notions of normal sexual behavior.
My objection to the one that prevails in 1986 is it's boring.
Right on that point, before we get too boring, let's throw to Paul.
Right, don't forget you're with Born Alive on Friday night. We want you to stay with us. We'll be back in part two with the discussion. There'll be plenty more to get your teeth into. Don't forget to phone us on Carlisle 37171. That's Born Alive 37171. Join us after the break.
Lads at the back have got some good points to make if you can get a mic to this side. Right, sorry, I didn't quite get that. I'm having breakup. Absolutely, I understand. I understand. Yeah, we'll try and get a mic to you, okay?
All the men have got flowers and the girls have.
Oh, that's a treat for the end.
Now did I was getting on the train.
Your cat forgot. What we've got is a very quick round-up now, because we overran slightly in the first half. So I'm going to do... Victoria, can you just spare me a minute? I'm going to do a quick phone round-up and then a 1, 2, 3.
Okay.
Yeah, phone all the people that have phoned in. We just say who's phoned in and what manic points have been put forward. And then we ask you for... Well, actually, it's turning... Plenty of reaction coming in now on the telephone. Mrs. Dean of Workington says Germain Greer is the only person making sense, but Bill Buckley has a point too. Homosexuality is not a disease. Mrs. Bell of Carlisle says that Bill Buckley shouldn't have been shouted at like that. Another one on your side. Mr. Thompson of Carlisle says the laws of the country are based on the laws of the Bible and that homosexuality is wrong. And a gentleman of Carlisle says, what would the man in the audience do if his son was a homosexual? Bill Buckley should have more support. Mrs. Winter of Roadhead says to Victoria Gillick, schools should teach children that sex is wonderful and also tell them about contraception. Victoria, is it the job of the school?
Oh, Lord, no. As a second best, I suppose, but first best parents. I don't understand about efficient sex education. Perhaps they ought to get them all lined up there and sort of doled out with their dinner money or something. No.
Well, let's stop there, because, in fact, Bill Buckley, a lot of people have phoned in support of you, and we're going to ask you now to stand up and go to the piano and sing a song that you've written specially for this programme, and I'm sure, in the circumstances, it will get a sympathetic hearing. So, Bill,
right, okay.
If you'd like to go to the piano, take a deep breath.
Thank you, yes.
And we'll
this, is, this is a song about people that I've met and known, and about the sad and isolated lives that some gay people, not all gay people, but some gay people do end up having. I take a shower and I wash my hair. painstakingly decide which clothes I want to wear. I iron them carefully, though they've been ironed before. I shave and brush my teeth, go out and lock the door. Run down the road and catch the bus to town. Pay my admission fee and take a look around. 200 faces in a disco rhythm sea. Dark ones and fair ones, but is there one for me? Well, sometimes I'm unlucky and I wander home alone, and I dream about what might have been as I make love on my own. And sometimes a handsome stranger takes me home and holds me tight. But either way, one thing's for sure, it's another lonely night. I don't deny my sexuality. I tell the world that this is how I'm meant to be. I say I'm not ashamed, that much is quite true. But I never tell them of the pain that I go through. Once I was so in love some years ago, but all too soon I couldn't wait to up and go. Two strong opposing wills and two unfaithful hearts. But now it's over, how I wish that it would start. Well, sometimes I'm unlucky and I wander home alone, and I dream about what might have been as I make love on my own. And sometimes a handsome stranger takes me home and holds me tight. But either way, one thing's for sure, it's another lonely night. When I told my mother, she very nearly died. And when I told my father, for the first time in his life he cried. And I can remember my shaking, angry voice as I tried in vain to tell them that I didn't have a choice. Well, sometimes I'm unlucky and I wander home alone, and I dream about what might have been as I make love on my own. And sometimes a handsome stranger takes me home and holds me tight. But either way, one thing's for sure, it's another lonely night.
Of which the sentiments might upset you, but its poignancy can't be denied. I'd just like to bring in a phone comment here from Mrs. Moorhead of Dumfries. Bill Buckley is right. No one has the right to tell someone else how to live. Well, it brings us on really to a very different sort of topic, and I'd like to introduce into the studio now Heather Stevenson-Snell. Heather, you're a therapist living in Penrith, but you've also got a great interest in something very different, and that's the Wicca. Now, I think for a layperson, I would be justified in saying that that's equivalent to witchcraft.
Yes. Well, the Wicca is actually a pre-Christian religion of a matriarchal nature. It recognizes the god force as being feminine in principle.
Is it the spells, potions, broomsticks type of witchcraft?
Well, it is and it isn't. The popular idea of witchcraft is, yes, but quite frankly it's based around the worship of nature.
And the worship of nature in female form, is that right?
Yes, the worship of the female aspect of the god force.
Now you have a statuette there which to some extent typifies your religious beliefs. What is it?
Yes, this is one of the goddess statues of the Wicca. This is Aphrodite, who represents the life force and the love force, which makes the universe go round.
And so it's very much a female thing. Germain, does this appeal to you?
Well, no. I'm only interested, well, I'm not only interested, but I'm principally interested in the aspect which has to do with women's management of health in particular. I'm a herbalist to some extent. I grow herbs and prepare them sometimes, use them sometimes, prescribe sometimes.
We'll talk about the cat and we really will begin to wonder.
Oh, and the cats talk to me and all that stuff. And
but Heather, is that the idea of witchcraft, that it is a female thing to do with health, to do with spells, to do with...
Well, it involves a certain amount of suggestion with regard to the spells. And also...
Do you chant spells, for example? Do you have a coven and do you go through this sort of ritual?
Well, I don't actually practice the Wicca.
But do people in the Wicca have covens and chant spells?
Well, yes, they do. I mean, I'm a psychotherapist by trade. It's more or less the same sort of thing. The spell is very much the same principle as in psychotherapy, the suggestion.
What do you think of that, Germain? Do you think it's a viable thing?
I think one of the problems about medicine is that you've got to induce a state of psychic readiness for a cure. Doctors do it in their own way by making mysteries out of things that are very simple. Witches do it by making, by getting people to conform to a long time consuming ritual so that they actually transcend their illness partly.
Do you think that's part of it?
I think that's quite right. I think, I think Mrs. Greer has hit the nail on the head.
So it's something we might all have a go at, perhaps something viable for us all?
Well, I don't know. I mean, a lot of people shy away from the occult because of its mystical element. Because of things like horror movies and black magic, which is simply a manifestation of psychotic illness.
Yours is the white magic, or the Wiccan is the white magic.
Seeing as it's Valentine's Day, can we ask if you've ever done a love spell or a love potion?
I have done one or two. Well, I have had people come to me and ask, can you do a love spell?
And do they work?
Well,
who knows? We'll have to leave it there. But from what we might call witchcraft to what we might call a witch hunt, Paul.
Yes, with me there's a board alive, Dr. Jim Cox. Eight is something that was in the discussion before. You might have seen in the papers tonight the discussion about AIDS and this programme. And Dr. Cox, is it a witch hunt, do you think?
Well, perhaps the most helpful thing I can do is to throw a few facts into the discussion. AIDS is caused by a virus. Only, as far as we know, only about 10% of people who catch the virus get AIDS illness, and that can take as long as 5 years. The way you catch the virus, it seems to be either by sharing a needle with a drug addict or through intercourse, and that's both homosexual and heterosexual intercourse between men and women, or by being born to a mother who has AIDS. Those are the ways you get it. The ways that nobody yet has been known to get it is by any more casual contact, is by shaking hands, kissing, living together, sharing a toothbrush, sharing a comb or a towel. These ways you don't catch AIDS.
Let's bring on Martin Weaver from the Terrence Higgins Trust, who's come up from London. Martin, welcome to the programme. What does the Terrence Higgins Trust do? Do you look after AIDS sufferers?
Yes, we're a voluntary organisation of at least 250 people, and we have two main aspects, that is services for people with AIDS and health education for everybody else.
Have you had the AIDS test and have you got AIDS?
Yeah, there's no AIDS test as such. No, I haven't got AIDS. The test I've actually had has been for the body's reaction to the virus. And what the doctors can tell me is that in the last 2 years or so, I've been in contact with the AIDS virus, and that's all they can tell me. It's just my body's reaction to that virus.
We have seen a lot in the papers. Is it a witch hunt? How do people who've got AIDS feel?
It's not so much a witch hunt. It's people who don't know what's going on, and they are very, very frightened, and they're very scared, and they're not being allowed to find out the information. If we go back to what we were talking about, Victorian values earlier on, that was about withholding information from people. And that's not what the trust is about.
Am I going to get AIDS by shaking hands with you?
Not at all. No chance.
All right. People in the audience, we were talking about AIDS. What do you think, Dr. Cameron, about this man and what people do to him?
I think it's an enormous shame that people respond out of fear to things.
and this is a very terrible disease. And however much we may agree or disagree with homosexual behaviour, we must certainly have the deepest respect and concern for people who are victims of this disease.
Coming back to you, what happens to people who've got AIDS? Are these? What is it like being a leper in the 20th century?
It's awful. It's the second time it's happened to me. I was down in Southampton, and another union didn't allow me into their studio. But after we actually talked to them and told them the real facts, they can't catch it from me being around here. They can't catch it from just talking to me. Then they were fine. It's basically about getting the right information, getting any information to people.
You are here?
Eventually, yes.
This is something we're all going to have to get used to, actually. That before very long, there are going to be lots and lots of people in the borders carrying the AIDS virus. There are already in London and Edinburgh and other major cities, and enormous numbers, thousands, possibly even 500,000 in America.
It's important that it's not AIDS that is the great problem. It is a problem, but what's worse is ignorance and fear, and people are preying on that.
In the audience, hands up those who are frightened of this man. Honestly. Anybody? No? Do you find that encouraging?
Yes, after what I've gone through in the last sort of 24 hours, yes. The information is getting through at last.
What's it like for you, I mean, as a person?
I tend to get used to it now. It's happened once before. It'll happen again, no doubt. And we can use every opportunity like this to get information out to everyone. And that's the important thing. It's dissemination of information that we're after.
Right. Dr. Cox, finally, is it going to get any better, do you think, people?
People are working very hard to try and find either a cure or a vaccine for AIDS. But there's neither in the foreseeable future. And the best thing that anybody can do is to try and prevent it. And that is to take great care not to either be a drug addict using sharing needles or having intercourse with somebody who's got the virus.
On that point, gentlemen, Liz.
Well, remember, we do have a phone number, that's Carlisle 37171, for your views on everything, including AIDS and our reactions to it. Some of the messages that have come in, one here that relates to Mrs. Victoria Gillick's point of view, a lady says she had contraceptives from the doctor when she was 15, but was too frightened to go back. She then got pregnant and had to have an abortion. She feels that this sort of thing will happen regardless of any law lord's ruling. But Mrs. Dagrosa of Selkirk says it's a pity there aren't more mothers like Victoria Gillick, so that's a pat on the back for Mrs. Gillick there. And we have an unusual comment here. This is from Bill of Dumfries. He says, this is a lovely programme. It's like a breath of sunshine. Well, thank you, Bill. But now then, let's look at something else, and that's modern erotica. We'd like you to take a look at this film of Raymond's Review Bar. Here it is, coming up now, I hope. Holding on. You might have found that rather disgusting, but it is the way of the world, albeit not in Hoyt or Wigton. With us is Paul Raymond of Raymond's Review Bar, who started the whole business, I think we can say, of that sort of sex show. Has it gone too far?
No, I don't think it's gone too far, quite frankly. I think it possibly was looking like that maybe 6, 7, 8 years ago. I would have thought today it's gone back a bit.
Really?
Incidentally, I have a handbag, but I'm not gay.
Fine, as long as we know. But you started out with things, really, I suppose, quite innocent things, like windmill-type nude statues standing there absolutely...
Well, not quite that. We were a little bit more adventurous than the old windmill was. No, we have done what we think is right. The Raymond Review Bar has been going for 28 years, and it's bigger now than it's ever been.
Has no one
it's
ever
a theatrical show.
But has no one ever asked you, aren't you exploiting women, showing these nude bodies of women, really,
oh,
for
my
money,
dear,
for
my
gain,
dear.
For your own gain?
Well, it's for my gain, it's for their gain too. if you're really saying that, aren't you really saying that the boss exploits his workforce? It's as simple as that.
Is that not a possibility?
Well, if you take that view, then every boss exploits the workforce, and then I would say that you may be right, I exploit my workforce.
Is it not a possibility?
Not because they're girls.
Is it not a possibility, though, that you're also exploiting the public because you're titillating the public? You're asking the public to go one step further down a certain road.
Well, obviously, I don't exploit them because they pay to see a theatrical show, either it's a circus, a pantomime, a ice show, or whatever it is. But I don't know what the word titillation means. If you tell me, then I can reply to you.
I would say sexual excitement in a contrived sort of format.
Sexual excitement where? In the head or elsewhere?
Well, wherever it turns you on, I suppose.
Ah, well, then I think the modern word is turns you on. Well, I must say, against me, my shows don't turn me on.
How then do you judge what's going to turn someone else on?
Well, because I'm a theatrical man, I've been an impresario for many years, and it's how does one decide whether the ballet is good or a ice show is good or whatever.
Why did
I'm
you
saying
go...
we are doing a noon show.
Why did you go into it then, Paul?
By mistake. I played Her Majesty's Carlisle, I played Workington, I played Theatre Royal Blythe, and we took £80 a week, you know, and I was the top of the bill doing my act, so you can tell how bad my act was. And it was a fluke. I had Vaudeville Express that did play the Theatre Royal Blythe and did play actually Workington and Empire Gateshead. And we had to go to the Hippodrome Colours of Manchester, and the man said, oh, you must have news. And we had two girls, the Clark twins, whatever they were called, and Vaudeville Express, which I was top of the bill, became a festival of nudes, and there was just two girls showing their boobs.
And do you reckon that you just responded to the need of the times?
Well,
no,
what I did respond to, that I realised that I wasn't top of the bill and the girls were. So that is how it all happened.
I'm talking of the girls now topping the bill. You're actually passing over a lot of your interest to your daughter, Debbie. Debbie, do you not feel it's slightly distasteful to take on a world where many people would say you're exploiting women, putting women's bodies on show?
Not in the slightest.
Why not?
How can you exploit women when they when they've got everything made for them? You know, they can work in a shop if they want to. They can sit at home with their husband or whatever. They can do shows like this. They can do what the hell they like.
Do you feel as a woman that you're quite capable of taking something like this on? Is it your sort of world?
Well, if a woman doesn't know how to turn a man on, who does?
And are you going to put your own expertise into the shows in a way your father didn't? I mean, he said his great benefit was to be objective from it, to be a showman and not to be involved.
Well, I hope that I will be able to do that. I think I will.
Right.
Yeah, but I think, actually, I think women are better off now than most young men are.
Yeah.
Most young men, of course, have got a dreadful inferiority complex because you've got women who, and not all women, of course, have a flat and will take guys home and can pick and choose.
So you actually think that women's got more than equality now?
Oh,
more than they've ever had.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
You would go along with that as well, Debbie?
Oh, absolutely.
To what extent do you think Raymond's review bar and your sort of shows have moved towards that? I would have said it was the reverse.
What I would say at the Raymond review bar, women have got a very good job. They don't have to do it if they don't want to.
They're
highly paid. Mm. And people want to see those shows. Mm. They're not going to do it for the rest of their life, but it is a theatrical performance.
Right, talking of theatrical performances, I think at this stage we've got one here on the set, looking very theatrical indeed, Paul.
And now, under protest, Paul Baird brings you underwear and nightwear through the ages. We've got a very unusual couple who've got an unusual collection of underwear. But first, this is what it was like in Edwardian times, I think. What a fool. Okay, I've taken the hat off with me. A Herbert and Mary Jackson from Maryport. I've one of the most extensive collections of underwear through the ages, Edwardian and Victorian. What I'd like to do is bring on Yolanda, who's dressed as a Victorian and Edwardian girl. We'll see what's happening, Matt.
What is she carrying?
She's carrying a Victorian bride pot. And that means that at the wedding breakfast, they filled the Victorian bride pot with rum punch and handed it round to toast the bride.
Where, Mary, did you get all your collection of underwear?
Well, some of it is family things that I've had, and the rest we've collected from various sources, shall we say. She's removing her blouse now, and which is made of cotton, and on the top of that she's wearing a nice black satin apron.
All has beautiful style, hasn't it? I mean, it's lovely.
Yes, it
lovely
has.
Material. I suppose you didn't have any man-made fabrics then, did you?
No. Everything that she's wearing is cotton, apart from the apron. A nice stripy underskirt.
What's the most unusual thing we don't know about underwear with your researches?
Oh, well, you see, I didn't know that until 1830, the ladies didn't wear the most essential garment, now known as briefs, etc.
Herbert.
May I just say, if your landlord will hold up the open drawers, which I'm sure could become popular again. They were known in Victorian times and Edwardians as harvest festivals, all is safely gathered in. And if you don't know, ask the person sitting next to you. They're also known as free traders, you could well imagine.
So when did we have knickers as we knew it?
Knickers as we know them came in about 1880. They closed up and got shorter in the leg.
And you're hoping to get more underwear, no doubt, to increase your collection.
Yes. What we really would love is a pair of Victorian corsets, but they're very...
Are they pretty difficult?
Yes, they are.
Yes, so, yes.
Thank you very much indeed. Liz, what do you think? I see you in this myself.
Yeah, I don't know. I wouldn't know where to put my hanky. Now then, we have a rather important phone comment here. It's from Michael of Kirby Thaw. He says he's had a friend in London for 4 years, and now because of AIDS, he don't go to visit him. Have we any advice? Michael, we'll be doing our very best for you. We'll be putting you in touch with the Terrence Higgins Trust and with our doctor before the end of the programme and hoping to come up with some advice for you there. Well, we've just looked at the whole body and clothing through the ages. Now we're going to look at the top knot, the hair, in fact. Earlier this evening, a local hairdresser's Thatch of Carlisle actually attached two people together. They became physically attached by the hair. We thought it'd be quite exciting to see how the hairstyle got going in our makeup department earlier this evening.
Young and beautiful, it's your duty to be beautiful. Keep young and beautiful if you want to be loved. Don't fail to do your stuff with a little powder and a puff. Keep young and beautiful. If you wanna be loved, if you're wise, exercise all the fat off. Take it off over here, over there. When you're seen anywhere with your hat off, have the Marcel wave in your hair, yeah. Take care of all those charms, and you'll always be in someone's arms. Keep young and beautiful if you wanna be loved. It's your duty to be beautiful. Keep yourself young and beautiful if you want to be.
Roger, Paul, why did you decide to do this for Valentine's Day?
Okay, Paul, I thought it would be a good idea to be attached for the whole day. Everything was going really well till about an hour ago. And poor old Mike wanted to go to the loo. it's all the booze you've been giving us upstairs.
I have to say this is Norton, is it? Can we compete with the London hairdressers?
Yeah, sure.
Are we up front now?
We're getting that way. I personally think that London hairdressers are such kind of prima donnas. They're so busy looking at what they're doing, is that us guys up in the north are moving on to them.
Excellent.
Yeah? Germain, yeah?
Roger Paul, excellent. Liz.
Can I say one thing? No.
No, we've got to
go. Can I, please?
Very quickly,
well,
yes.
Look, the reason why we did this, we're doing a road show, a thatch hair road show that's going out in Scotland over the next 3 weeks. It's to raise money for multiple cirrhosis. Please come to the road show. Okay, Paul?
Okay, Roger.
Thank
Liz.
You.
Oh, he certainly can work us, can't he?
Thanks, guys.
Oh. just like at this point to bring us back into the body of the main discussion, as you might say. Mrs. Budd of Annan says, it's terrible the way AIDS sufferers are treated. They are treated like lepers. Bill, if I could just come to you, does all this discussion of AIDS worry you? Do you think it is a scourge or...
It's undoubtedly a scourge because it kills people and it is as bad as the plague was, yes. I mean, it's a terrible thing.
Do you see it as some sort of punishment?
I don't see it as a punishment, except possibly you could argue it's a punishment for extreme promiscuity.
In which case, I've got it!
Boasting
again.
I just want to make, you know, clear one more time that the vast majority of gay people go through no more partners during their life than the vast majority of heterosexual people. Many of them never have a partner at all because of the way they're forced to live their life in the shadows. So they're not responsible for it.
If I could come then straight on to Victoria, you would perhaps be against the idea of heterosexual people having more than one partner or many partners in their lives.
Well, it probably doesn't make life that much easier for them if, in fact, you're wanting to settle down and get married and be quite normal afterwards. I would have thought it made staying with one person rather difficult, but if you intend to be promiscuous all your life, well, you might as well start at the earliest opportunity. I'm being cynical here.
I mean, but, if I could come to Germain, is promiscuity totally out of line with normality, which is what Victoria was hinting?
Oh, probably, yes. I don't really terribly want to be normal. Actually, it's not an ambition of mine. Exactly. Can I just say something rather crabby about all this AIDS business? I'm fed up to the teeth with AIDS. I mean, there are women in this country who are dying of cervical cancer, which is something we know how to deal with. We could save their lives. We let them die. I don't understand it. We're running around like hens chasing with our heads
you
chopped off,
understand.
Running about AIDS, and we've got perfectly monogamous, law-abiding, uncomplaining
does that make
females.
Them any better?
No, it doesn't. It doesn't. It gives them an equal case before the law.
But you
and they're
must
being ignored.
Why.
Right, we'll
you
stop there. Thank you very
why.
Much because I think we've brought that point up. You've brought that point up very adequately. Over now to Paul.
It's men.
We're back with Des now. Des, which man in the audience did you pick?
Well, we have Jonathan here who's got a Valentine for Maureen in Wetherall. So here you are, Maureen. You're the sunrise in the morning. Believe me when I say, you are the wind beneath my wings. Be my Valentine today.
You're on for a cooked breakfast. and one for Herbert to marry. He's never given a Valentine before. What's that?
Oh, bless you.
Well, Herbert is a celebrant of dogs in general and bulldogs in particular. So this is to Mary from Herbert. Oh, let me be your bulldog, your champion bold and true. Let me protect your underwear and stand guard over you. You've been my Valentine for years, as I know I've been yours. So this one is for you, my dear, the first of many more.
Des, well done. Thank you very much indeed. We also have something increasingly special. Brown Pamela Wilson, you have gone to all the trouble, my dear, haven't you, of bringing a black wedding dress to Carlisle from Paris. Let's have a look at the black wedding dress. This has to be the ultimate for Valentine's Day. Why did you bring it over?
Well, it's just something different, something new. I would just like to introduce this into Carlisle. I have indeed been asked for black in the past. I never really thought that I'd get the opportunity to buy it, but there you have, we've got it now.
Do you honestly think Cumbrians and the people in Scotland are going to wear...
I do.
I don't know where
yes,
I'm...
definitely.
It's only because Valentine's Day I'm holding your hand. Liz, I see you when you were married. I see you in that sort of thing.
Good grief, no, I don't think that's me at all.
Oh,
far too elegant.
Lovely, isn't it?
Right, at this point, could I say that there is nothing new under the sun? Because Paul Raymond tells us that one of his girls in the review bar in the 50s actually did get married in a black wedding dress. So there you go, there's never anything special, is there? Now then, having said that, perhaps we have got something special for you, because you might remember that on Look Around earlier in the week, Paul actually appealed for a couple to come on the air and live get engaged. That is, pop the question. Well, you'll have thought, no one's going to be daft enough to do that, but here they are. Are you all daft in Wigton?
Yes.
Louise and Colin, this is your big moment. Now, you're not going to hide away in the audience and do it, so come on down, as they say. Colin, right? May I take you by the hand? Louise, that's great. Now, let me get you well organised over here. Right. Okie doke. Now then, that's it, the big moment. But you're not just going to stand there and do it. Can you pass me that red cushion, please? Okay. Right. There you go. I'm going to move out now. You're going to go down on one knee. Have you got the ring at the ready?
No.
Oh, you have. No, don't do that to me. Down on one knee, ask the question. You give the answer, OK? Have you got your words right?
Well,
I'm going to let you get on with it.
Louise, will you marry me?
Yes. Before you go, right, just stay here with us. Can I congratulate you? Can I congratulate him?
I think I can do one better, Liz. Where's the most romantic place in Britain to get married? That's Gretna. Come on down, Debbie and Joe. What were you doing? What were you doing at 10 o'clock this morning?
Getting married.
At Gretna. How was the architect? Because you come all the way from Cheltenham. What was it like?
Lovely.
Great.
It was just a stupendous day. It really was. It was tremendous.
Some people think that maybe doing that is a bit old-fashioned, a bit eloping
No, full of feeling, completely different. Not a lot of people do it, you see. Would it be completely different for everybody else?
Well, you certainly were, Liz.
Right, well, we can't really have engaged couples and married couples without presents, past the gifts.
It's the least we can do for you,
son.
It's
the
least we can do for you.
It's quite a good present.
Right, but we want to end on a romantic note. Now, what could be more romantic than engagements, weddings, and, of course, we've got to have champers to go with it. Did you know that we, the British, are now drinking more champagne than we have done for 100 years? So bring on the champers. John Green from Jennings Brewery, are you going to pop the cork?
I'm going to pop the cork.
All right, you get working on that.
Sunflowers have brought us a rose for everybody, so we're going to end. There's only one way.
Borders way.
Be nice to each other.
Cheerio.
Cheerio.
Right, here comes the champers.